My name is Chris Collier. I'm the executive director of Renew Theaters, which manages the Ambler Theater, County Theater, Highway Theater, and Princeton Garden. And we're really excited to have you back for another discussion of a classic Hollywood film. As always, in the more than capable hands of Hannah Jack. We're excited tonight to be discussing Double Indemnity. And I think there's going to be a lot of wonderful comments to come out of this. Before I turn things over to Hannah, just a couple housekeeping notes. There are deep focus discussions going on all summer. And for those of you who can't get enough classic Hollywood, in pairing with our Hollywood Summer Night series going on at the theaters, we also have a couple additional classic Hollywood films coming up. So Alan, who I just see has signed on, will be discussing The Shop Around the Corner on Tuesday, August 2nd. So I do hope you'll join us for that. And there are some other wonderful seminars coming up all summer long, and you can find those on deepfocus.film. Of course, the whole Deep Focus series is sponsored by the VESTA Fund, which allows us to put these wonderful programs together and to have so many wonderful and interesting speakers to share these moments together to discuss film. So in addition to the Classic Hollywood series, we're also wrapping up our French New Wave series. We are launching a new series on Black independent film. And there is a fantastic series by the team at Milestone Films looking at forgotten films from their vault, some really interesting silent titles. So I urge you to check out deepfocus.film and see all of the wonderful programs that are going on there. In terms of Zoom protocols, we ask that you all please stay on mute, especially in the beginning, as Hannah does her intro, and then we'll open things up for discussion. Since this is a larger group, ask if you use the raise hand feature, and I will help moderate and call on people. Also, so that this feels like a round table, encourage all of you to turn your cameras on so that we can see you. It is much nicer to see faces, and it feels like, even though we're all in different places, like we're in a circle together chatting about films, or in the theater even, instead of just looking at blank boxes. And the chat is enabled. The chat is always a wonderful place for sidebar conversation. There's always a lot of IMDb sleuthing going on and sharing of favorite quotes and other things in there, and that often gets pulled into the main conversation. So please take good use of the chat, and I look forward to seeing what comments come up. And I think without anything further, it is my pleasure as always to turn things over to Hannah Jack, who's a writer for TCM and has been our guide through all of these classic films over the past 2 years. And I think, Hannah, you might be talking about our next couple films, because I think we have them finally lined up. So over to you, Hannah.
Yes, thank you all so much for being here. I'm thrilled to see the crowd that has turned out, thrilled but not surprised, who's turned out for this discussion for Double Indemnity. And I do want to reiterate Chris's invitation to show us your faces. Don't worry about your background. Don't worry if you're cooking dinner. It's lovely to see everyone who's here, and we have quite a big crowd who is here tonight. So as Chris said, I've been in the habit of teasing next month's movie up front at the beginning of these talks so that you can mark your calendars. It's such a joy and a privilege and a thrill for me to see so many of you returning month after month, and especially to see some new faces each month too. So if you're new to this series, we do this every month about a different classic Hollywood film, often based on your own requests and suggestions. And we have picked out the next couple titles, but I will just mention next month's right now. On August 16th, that's another Tuesday at 7:30, we're gonna be meeting to discuss a comedy. It's from 1950. And I've mentioned this before, because if you were with us for Sunset Boulevard, I said that the performance Gloria Swanson gave as Norma Desmond in Sunset Boulevard was nominated for an Academy Award. She was up against Bette Davis for All About Eve. Neither of them won. The Oscar that year went to the only actress in the category who was nominated for a comedy. And that was Judy Holliday for the movie we'll be discussing, Born Yesterday, from 1950. So this is really a special movie, a special comedy, and it co-stars William Holden and Broderick Crawford, and is directed by a director we somehow have managed to overlook so far in this series, George Cukor, who is one of the great directors of classic Hollywood. So we will be talking about Born Yesterday on August 16th next month. Speaking of August, I just also want to note, because I know a lot of there are a lot of Turner Classic Movies fans in the crowd, August is every year on TCM a month that we call Summer Under the Stars, which is a 31-day marathon where every day in August, TCM has dedicated to a different Hollywood star. So if you're looking to do kind of a deep dive into different stars' filmographies, there's no better opportunity than the month of August on TCM. Every year there are a couple of like perennial favorites who show up, who you know their movies. And then there are always a few kind of surprise, star of the day, individuals who maybe don't get to be in the spotlight so much. So definitely check out the programming in August and set your DVRs. That's very, very exciting. And I worked on a lot of movies for that lineup. So without further ado, I'm gonna dive into tonight's film. And I am gonna go ahead and share my screen and share some images as I'm talking. As always, fill the chat with your thoughts and your questions. And once I'm done talking, we will open this up because there's a lot to say about this movie. Before I begin, special shout out to Brian's t-shirt, which I see here. Way to wear a Barbara Stanwyck shirt. There we go, excellent. That is from our dear friend, KateGabrielle.com. If you go to her website, you can buy that shirt. It's a great shirt. So I'm gonna go ahead and try to share my screen with you here. So we can see some visuals. Give me one moment. And here we go. Thumbs up if we see these two scandalous people. Great. So sometimes in this series, and I want to apologize in advance, I have this like weird shade light on my face, but I feel like for this movie, that's very appropriate. The Venetian blind light kind of hitting me in this way. So I'm going to try to stay out of it. But every once in a while, I get the opportunity to talk about a movie here that really and truly changed the course of movie history. And this is one of them. Double Indemnity is a movie that our TCM host, Eddie Muller, who has been called the czar of noir, he is the foremost expert on film noir. Eddie Muller has called this the definitive film noir. Not the first film noir, but really the one that opened the floodgates for the genre and the era, the classic era that we think of as film noir. And I'll circle back to that idea at the end and kind of explain how that happened. But before we get there, I want to kind of give some production history and background as I tend to do here. I'll start with the story, the source material for this movie. It was written by a man named James M. Cain, whose name you might know. He, back in 1934, now remember, Double Indemnity is 1944, so a decade earlier, James M. Cain was an aspiring screenwriter, a former newspaper man, who wrote a small little book that turned out to be a bestseller. It was a story about an adulterous woman who gets her lover to help her commit murder. And it was called not Double Indemnity. It was called The Postman Always Rings Twice. And that book was published in 1934. And it became a surprise bestseller. Now, MGM quickly bought the rights to this book. But if you've been with us recently, we've been talking a lot about the Hollywood Production Code. And 1934 was the year that that code went into full effect. So there was never any hope of a scandalous book about sex and adultery and murder being made into a movie in 1934. This wasn't gonna happen. Meantime, James M. Cain is writing more stories, and he rehashes essentially the same story 2 years later in another small book called Double Indemnity. That it was written in 1936, but not published until 1943. Takes us very close to our movie. 1943, Double Indemnity is published in a group of three stories by James M. Cain in this volume that you see on the right there called Three of a Kind. And that's where our movie starts to get underway. So 1943, a producer at Paramount named Joe Sistrom gets his hands on a copy of Three of a Kind, and he gives it to the studio's hottest new director, Billy Wilder. Not the first time we've talked about Billy Wilder in this series, nor will it be the last time. Billy Wilder was one of the, you know, greats in Hollywood, in classic Hollywood, especially at this point. Billy Wilder when last we spoke about him in this series, it was with Ninotchka when he was just still a screenwriter. Started out as a screenwriter, was a very, very acclaimed screenwriter, mostly of comedies in the 1930s and early 40s, and had just stepped into the director's chair in 1942, directed his first movie, The Major and the Minor, which was a comedy, and then followed it with a war movie called Five Graves to Cairo, and that's it. He had not directed anything else before Double Indemnity. Only made two movies before this movie, which blows my mind. But he had two directorial credits, and they were both hits, and he was Paramount's hottest director. So into his hands fell this book. Legend has it that he gave it to his secretary to read, these three stories by James M. Cain, and she disappeared. And everyone was looking for her, and she was in the bathroom. She couldn't stop reading this one book, this one story, Double Indemnity. And Billy Wilder figured, well, if she was that enthralled by it, it must be good. And he read it and was excited. Well, Billy Wilder, as I said, was known for making these comedies, but he had other aspirations. What he really wanted to do was make a thriller to rival his contemporary Hollywood immigrant, Alfred Hitchcock. He wanted to make a Hitchcock-like movie. And when he read Double Indemnity, he was sold. Unfortunately for Billy Wilder, his writing partner, Charles Brackett, was not sold at all. On the left-hand side there, you see Billy Wilder and Charles Brackett. They came up together as screenwriters. They were a really good kind of blend. And Charles Brackett, they were very different kinds of people. Billy Wilder was this like crass German immigrant who had all these, you know, he was in tune with like the baser impulses of human beings. Charles Brackett was this very refined, sophisticated, well-educated Boston blue blood. And when he read James M. Cain's sordid little tale of sex and murder, he wanted nothing to do with it. He did not want his name on this at all. So he parted ways with Wilder for this project. And Billy Wilder, that didn't really work well for him because what he needed was a writing partner. His process very much involved, as you can infer from this picture, him walking up and down his office and, you know, swishing his riding crop around and shouting ideas, and he needed someone to bounce ideas off of. Well, so producer Joe Sistrom suggested another writer whose crime stories he really liked, and this was a man named Raymond Chandler. Raymond Chandler was famous for writing detective stories focused on the famous literary detective Philip Marlowe, stories like The Big Sleep and Farewell My Lovely, which all got made into great Hollywood movies. Raymond Chandler had never written a screenplay though. He was also a struggling alcoholic, and he and Billy Wilder hated each other from the minute they got together. Their collaboration was just fraught with tension because they just didn't, they were two very different personalities who did not have anything like a similar working style. And they really didn't, it was not a partnership that was happy at any point. However, in 7 weeks, they wrote a screenplay together that revolutionized the movie industry. And basically they introduced something that really was new, which was a story where the main characters are totally unsympathetic. They are cold, they are calculating, they're driven by lust and greed. And they just had this moral apathy that was unlike anything Hollywood had seen before in a big prestigious picture. It blended these qualities that these two men had, somehow blended together beautifully. Billy Wilder's cynical attitude, which comes through even in his comedies, and his dark sense of humor. And then Raymond Chandler had just such an ear for hard-boiled dialogue. And so together they created this really, really great script. which was the entire basis of this movie. Kind of everything you love about Double Indemnity was in the script that they created. They parted the worst of enemies, and yet Billy Wilder did acknowledge Raymond Chandler's contributions to this movie with a cameo. So next time you watch, you can find Raymond Chandler in the movie. He's sitting on a chair outside of Barton Keyes' office at one moment. So look for him next time. And then the other kind of stroke of genius behind this film was Billy Wilder's casting choices, which really the genius lies with Wilder in this one. He chose to cast as murderers two actors who were beloved for playing romantic and light comic characters. The first was Barbara Stanwyck. Barbara Stanwyck she had just a ridiculously long career. I mean, rightfully so. She was one of the greatest actresses of her time, but she had already starred in 43 movies at this point, and yet had never played what she called an out and out killer. This was a departure for her. She had played tough roles before, but never someone who was this evil. And that scared her, and she was hesitant. She was Wilder's first choice for Phyllis Dietrichson, but she hesitated because she thought that it would alienate her fans. She thought that this was not a role that would endear her to anybody. But she wanted to work with Wilder, and he apparently challenged her in just the right way by saying, "Well, are you an actress or are you a mouse?" And she said, "Well, I hope I'm an actress." And she took the part, and it was a risk that more than paid off, because nowadays it's regarded as one of her best roles, and certainly one that most people think of when they think of Stanwyck's career. And then yet casting the role of Walter Neff proved to be a lot more challenging. A couple actors were considered. Alan Ladd was the first one that Billy Wilder approached. Alan Ladd did have a pretty robust career in crime dramas, but he turned the part down. George Raft, who also was famous for playing gangsters in the movies, turned it down. George Raft sort of made a career turning down every big role in Hollywood. He turned down The Maltese Falcon, he turned down Casablanca, and he turned down Double Indemnity. He apparently said to Wilder, he heard Wilder kind of recount the plot of this movie, and at the end he said, "Well, where's the lapel?" And Wilder said, "What lapel?" And he said, "Well, at what point does the character like flip over his lapel and show his FBI badge that he was the good guy all along?" And Wilder said, "Well, that doesn't happen." And Raft said, "Well, no, forget that. He would not play a character who was just that bad." And so Wilder turned to somebody who had not ever played any character who was sort of, you know, corrupt, and that was Fred McMurray. Fred McMurray was his own like response to the offer. He said, "I'm a saxophone player," which he was. He started off playing saxophone in a big band, and he said, "I make romantic comedies with Carol Lombard," which he also was. That's what he was famous for. He was famous for playing these, you know, light kind of playboy types in romantic comedies. At this point in his career, always likable characters. He also had starred opposite Barbara Stanwyck once before in a movie that many of you may have seen. It's a classic Christmas classic that plays every year called Remember the Night from 1940, which is also, again, it's a charming romance. It's not anything dark or sinister. But Fred McMurray did take on the challenge and really showed his acting chops in a way that no other role before this had allowed him to. And he, again, would go on to play a thoroughly unlikable guy 16 years later in his next collaboration with Billy Wilder, which was The Apartment. He is Mr. Sheldrake, the executive who uses Jack Lemmon for his apartment to have an affair with Shirley MacLaine. And when he made The Apartment in 1960, the fan mail poured in chastising Fred McMurray for playing such an unlikable guy. And I guess people just forgot that he had played such an unlikable guy in an earlier Billy Wilder movie. So then, of course, we have to talk about the third star of this movie, who is Edward G. Robinson. So Edward G. Robinson, at this point in his career, also was known for a particular type. He was known for playing gangsters. That's a big misnomer, because when you look at his career, he played everything and did it all well. And he really had a range that was incredibly remarkable. But he, in 1930, kind of burst onto the screen in this gangster role in Little Caesar, which was one of the landmark early gangster movies. And that became the indelible image, I mean, in cartoons and everything ever since. The number of homages to, you know, the three-piece suit and the big cigar and the way that he talked, that was Edward G. Robinson. So he was a big star in his own right. Yet in 1944, he's 49 years old, and he realized that at this point, his career was moving more into character parts, not stars. And he was a little reluctant to step into this, but he knew that this was going to be where his career was heading. So he accepted the part and really gave one of his best performances here as Barton Keyes. Interestingly, still kind of the villain of the picture and kind of the tough, you know, powerhouse, but on the right side of the law, not, you know, the gangster that he was known for. Incredibly, he was not nominated for an Oscar for this performance, and neither was Fred McMurray. And really more incredibly, I think, Robinson never was nominated for an Oscar in his career, which I think is a huge oversight, and neither was McMurray. But Double Indemnity did earn 7 Oscar nominations. These are the 7. It was nominated for Best Picture. Stanwyck was nominated for Best Actress. Billy Wilder for both directing and co-writing the screenplay. He did not invite Raymond Chandler to the Oscars party, which Chandler always resented, but they were nominated together. John F. Seitz is the cinematographer here who worked with Billy Wilder a lot, including on Sunset Boulevard, which we talked about a couple months ago. And he was nominated for his cinematography. And this score was by Miklos Rosa, who had a very long and very successful career as a Hollywood composer. Famously for Ben-Hur, he wrote the score that won him the Oscar for Ben-Hur. That's his music there. Now, as I said, they was nominated for 7 Oscars, did not win any. All of the Oscars that year went to other movies, and Billy Wilder the next year would win for both director and for his screenplay for another movie called The Lost Weekend, which was the first Hollywood movie to deal seriously with the topic of alcoholism. That was a movie about an alcoholic writer. And Billy Wilder wrote it after working with Raymond Chandler on Double Indemnity, who was, as I said, a struggling alcoholic. And that was what inspired The Lost Weekend, which came the following year. Double Indemnity lost most of its Oscars to the Bing Crosby musical Going My Way, which if you don't know that movie or don't remember it so well, that's because I think Double Indemnity kind of got the last laugh in the end, because it's the one that had the bigger impact and really changed, as I said, the course of Hollywood history, opening the doors for the era and the genre that we think of as the peak of film noir. At the time, film noir was not the name given to these movies. They were called either melodramas or crime pictures. Because what they had in common was crime. Crime was kind of the common denominator of all of these movies. They are so varied, though. So when we take a look at noir, I mean, you have everything from, you know, more romantic movies to heist movies to you know, boxing dramas. They run a huge gamut. But what Double Indemnity did was it was a huge, huge success, and commercially and critically. And that is what signaled to all the studios that audiences were ready for this. Prior to the mid-1940s, Hollywood was really churning out very uplifting, sugar-coated movies with happy endings, in part as a distraction from the Depression, in part as a distraction from World War II, and really because that was a formula that seemed to work in the 1930s and early 40s. But what happened was the war happened, and then the soldiers returning from the war had seen a lot of terrible things and came back ready for movies that kind of looked at the world and said, you know what? There's a lot of terrible stuff in the world, and took a more cynical approach to storytelling. And that's where you get the most robust period of noir, which is in the immediate aftermath of World War II. So again, Double Indemnity is 1944, and it signals to everyone in Hollywood, audiences are ready, audiences can handle it. If there's something, you know, sordid and horrible going on screen, they want to see it. If it doesn't end well, they want to see it. They're okay with it. And that's where you get this period of film noir. So that's where I'm going to pause. And there's so much to talk about with this movie, with noir, with kind of everything involved. And I know that there are a lot of people here who came here to talk about this movie. So I'm going to kind of leave it open-ended. But if you would like to start by maybe commenting on the style of this movie, maybe some of the characters, what you thought of it, I will open it up and you can use the raise hand feature and Chris will help moderate.
Yes, Brian.
Yeah, I love this film. It was one of the first film noirs I ever saw back in VHS. One of the interesting things is Howard Neff is not an innocent led to slaughter or led astray by the woman. It's heavily suggested that he's a womanizer. He admits to having thought of ways to cheat the company. He just needs the littlest of push to push him onto the dark side. And once he does that and the murder's committed, he seems to really lose all interest in Phyllis. He just wants to get away with it. He's not even really that interested in the money, it seems. He never mentions what he's going to spend the money on, or what elaborate plans he has. He's just happy to have done it. It's not until he sees what his act did to Dietrich's daughter and the fact that Phyllis might be leaving him for another man that he finally gets his moral compass back. And by far my favorite scene of the movie is when Edward G. Robinson recites all the different ways you can commit suicide, and falling off the back of the train is not in any of his books. That is a powerhouse scene, might be one of my favorite scenes in all of cinema. It's just great. And I could go on forever, but I'll just leave it there.
Absolutely. Yeah, I mean, I would love to hear other people's comments about that. That definitely Walter Neff's motives is something that can definitely be unpacked. So I certainly have my thoughts, but I want to hear what other people have to say. What do you think about Neff as a character and his motives in this movie?
Mindy, I saw your hand up next.
Well, not to comment on the last comment, but I was just going back to wondering if Hannah knew, was this the first sort of major film that Stanwyck was a blonde?
Her hair tone kind of varied from one movie to the next, but yeah, the wig is definitely something that people talk about in this movie. It is very kind of overly stylized, it's awkward, it's like it's over the top and it's fake, and I think that, you know, it was not Billy Wilder knew what he was doing, I think, because he's, you know, Walter Neff is supposed to look at this woman who we see as being conniving and evil from the beginning, and he sees right past it, and he jumps on board with her. And I think the obviousness of her blonde, fakeness, I think is part of her character. But yeah, it's definitely a statement.
Edward? Oh, Edward, I think you're still on mute.
This is one of my all-time favorite films, and I'm so lucky that I saw the announcement in the theater webpage. The side of it that really intrigues me is the relationship between Neff and Keyes, and the fact that to me it seems that Neff originally was totally against the idea of the murder, and I thought it was actually ridiculous given the fanatical efficiency of Keyes. And by the way, I should mention that there are a number of other favorite scenes that I have. One is the scene of the guy who tried to torch his truck and how Keyes deals with him. And the other, and probably my favorite in the film, is when Barbara Stanwyck comes in to talk to the head of the company who inherited the company. And he says, well, some people think that just because a man occupies a big office, he must be an idiot. And then he proves that he is so. And Keyes just delivers. I mean, how people were able to write such dialogue. That's why I love these classic films, because you see the brains that went into creating the dialogue. But to get back to Keyes and Neff, there is this kind of a bromance of a combination of fraternity and rivalry, and it seems that Neff was smarting under the Keyes' idea that sales was just inferior to the kind of detective work that he did, and why couldn't he come along and be his apprentice and take a pay cut? So I think it's, to me, especially because the film really begins with him dictating, to me it's really the story of this really complex workplace relationship between two guys, in which the woman, of course, plays a really key part as femme fatale, but really that material would not have been ignited if it hadn't been for this work relationship.
Yes, Edward, first of all, thank you. I'm so glad you're joining us for this conversation. I hope you'll be back for others. I'm glad that you saw the announcement on the website too. I hope that that works for many people. But I will say that the relationship between Keyes and Neff was something that Billy Wilder and Raymond Chandler really played up. It was not as played up in James M. Cain's original story. And Cain loved this movie. He thought that the movie did so much better with the material than the book did, and that it elevated it. And part of that was that relationship. Another part that Wilder and Chandler added was this technique of the dictaphone being the way that the story is framed in flashback. They added Neff beginning by confessing and adding this narration. Narration, of course, would become a trope of film noir, but this was kind of where it began. And that relationship between Keyes and Neff is, I agree 100%, is the movie. It's how the movie begins, and it's how it ends. This a lot of people have commented that it's a father-son relationship, and that the emotional heart of this story is the betrayal of the son to the father, and that that's what drives the whole story, is that he's trying to. You're right. He's not. I mean, the comments about how Neff is not interested in murder. He is kind of interested in Phyllis, but he's really, really interested in gaming the system. He's really interested in seeing in this idea that he can get, he, Walter Neff, nobody else can get away with it. And the only person who's able to maybe call him out is Keyes. So that dynamic is definitely much of the heart of this story. I see so many hands. I want to hear other people's thoughts. Yeah.
Next up is Polly.
Hi, there's so many things to talk about, but I'll try to keep it short. I love the first two scenes between the two set pieces in the house. Those to me are, like Brian was saying, another scene was one of his favorites. Those two are among my favorites in all of the movies. In just great performances and great dialogue, including some really hilariously salacious dialogue that's sort of shocking even today. Yeah. And the fact they got it, you know, through the censors is really funny. But I think that there's like a big power dynamic going on between Walter and Phyllis. Like, he's the salesman, he's the aggressor in his mind, he's all cocky. Such a nuanced performance from McMurray, which is really gets better the more you watch the movie. And for someone who grew up with him as like the father on My Three Sons, it's hard to sort of square. But yeah, so then it's just this power play dynamic, and he's the one commenting on her anklet and this and that. And she's, well, do you, you know, and then there's, do you understand? Yes, I think I do. But he really gets the wind blown out of him when he realizes that she's playing him. So right. I think that's a turning point for me, for him. I also wanted to see if there's time to talk about the gas chamber ending, but there may not be time. Later,
I can definitely comment on it briefly. There was an alternate ending shot for this movie that you may know about, that where Neff goes to the gas chambers and Keyes watches him be executed for this crime. And that's like it was shot and they had it, you know, there was footage of it at one point. It's become kind of a holy grail for, you know, the film noir fan community, but all signs point to the idea that it was destroyed. Wilder did not like it. He thought that the emotional story ends when Neff is, you know, falling apart in front of Keyes, and the implication being that he's not long for this world anyway, and that was kind of where nobody needed anything beyond that. But there was this other ending that they shot and did not use. Which, by the way, I will say also that in the book, Neff and Phyllis escape on a boat, and then in like a double suicide pact, they like jump off and to be eaten by a shark. And so that ending was also kind of flawed, to say the least, but yeah.
I'll just throw one more comment. I've read that Wilder later said that the wig was a mistake, but he was kind of stuck with it. But I think it works beautifully. I mean, there's nothing crazier than that photo of them in the shopping together with her with the glasses on. So
yeah, oh, absolutely. And I think that he, you know, he may have revisited, he may have rethought it later, but I think in the time he was not regretting it while during the production.
Yeah. Alan?
Oh, thank you, Chris. I'm so glad we're talking about this movie. Like many people here tonight, I've seen this movie, I don't know how many times, and it never gets old. And it's always like the most fun movie imaginable about a sociopath. And what's amazing about it is how, even though Phyllis in particular and Walter too are not likable, we're kind of with them as they descend into deeper and deeper like desperation and cheapness, and everything just makes sense and hangs together. The one place, and it's very small and it's at the end, but the one thing that unravels a little for me, and I wonder if anybody would care to comment on this, although I'm not sure how much there is to say, but there's some intimation at the end that Phyllis's real romance, the place where she's real, is with Nino Zucchetti, who is dating her stepdaughter Lola. And it's like, really? She's with this like cheap punk? Like they're the two? I don't know. That's the one thing I'd say, okay, fine, you know. But I just wondered if anyone had anything to say about, you know, him as a character and Phyllis and him, really? Just, I don't see it.
Anyone want to weigh in on the Phyllis Nino spinoff?
Edward? Oh, you're on mute again, Edward.
I recall that at some point it was implied, and maybe I was just imagining this, but I recall at some point it was implied that she was going to get rid of him next, that he was really kind of a means to an end in this chain of husbands and lovers, and that she was just going to go on and on with it. But There was no clearly no sequel to this film, so she didn't, get to do it.
Yeah, I think the implication also that she's trying to destroy Lola's life as much as possible, and you know, turning him against her was part of that arrangement.
And speaking of Lola, the scene where she talks about Phyllis being responsible for the death of her mother is absolutely chilling. I mean, it's just, you know, that's where we really see how nakedly selfish and vicious Phyllis is. And you're right about the scene in the novel where they're on the boat, she's in that white makeup. It's like too creepy for Hollywood. Like they couldn't do that.
Absolutely.
Tom, you're up next.
Okay, great. Thank you. I two things. First of all, just while we're talking about the ending, the one thing that I just still am not sure of as many times as I've seen the film is why she didn't shoot Fred McMurray. I mean, she was depicted as so cold, so hard, so vicious, and yet at that key moment, having shot him once already, she just can't finish it. And I'm not sure why, and I don't know why. But you know, it allows Fred McMurray's character Neff, of course, to do the narrative, which. You know, they could have pulled the Sunset Boulevard and had him do it from, you know, a post-mortem narrative, but anyway, that's not a complaint about the film. It's just kind of like, I just expect her character is so well-drawn as so selfish and so vicious that I expected her to shoot him. The other thing though, that really struck me, and again, like most people, a lot of people here, I've seen this many times, And really struck me as a key part of noir is smoking. The cigarettes, the cigars. If you had to add up how many cigarettes, but they're very, very expressive. You know, when he's confident, he's holding it one way. When he's starting to get nervous, he's holding it another. And then there's the final scene where he's laying there. What does he do? Pulls up this battered, beat up cigarette that he can't even light anymore. And, you know, I think that's an essential noir that keeps going on, just that. And of course, Edward G. Robinson has the big cigars, which gives him a certain gravitas and a certain, presence beyond that. I don't know why it struck me in watching it this time, but it just is, I guess, just because they were lighting up all the time. You don't see that in movies too much today. But it was a very purposeful. It wasn't just doing something with their hands. It was very purposeful to the characters and how the characters were feeling, and especially Fred McMurray's character.
Absolutely. I'm so glad you brought that up. Next time you watch this movie, or any Billy Wilder movie for that matter, the little bits of business that they do, that the actors do with their props, he had such a genius for directing those moments. And of course, he had real pros working with those props. I mean, Barbara Stanwyck goes over and, you know, shifts something on the table, and it's like, it means something, you know, but he really always did that little gesture where McMurray flicks the match to light it, and then he can't do it in the last moment. I mean, all of that is so purposeful, but I'm glad you brought that up. Absolutely.
Risa?
Hear me?
Yeah.
Yeah, it was interesting because I didn't know that there were matches that you could just go like that and they light. That seemed very dangerous, actually, to have those kinds of matches without having to strike them. I wonder if you could say something about the actor who played her husband, Phyllis's husband.
Yeah, I mean, his name was Tom Powers. He was a character actor in a lot of things, and his biggest success came on the stage. He had a long career, but he was not... In the movies, there wasn't a role that really distinguished him beyond this one. This was kind of the role that he's most remembered for in movies.
Yeah. And the girl who played...
Lola, the girl who played Lola. Yeah, Jean Heather is her name. She also appeared in the movie I mentioned, Going My Way, the Bing Crosby musical that won all the Oscars that year. Those are kind of her two bigger, better known things. Really tragically, 3 years after this, she was in a car accident that disfigured her face. And so her movie career ended. Her life didn't end, but her movie career, that was it for her. So very, very brief career. Yeah.
And Keith? You're on mute still, Keith.
Sorry, I thought I'd click that. I have something to respond to both Tom and to Alan about the cigarettes. You know, that's a marker of romance in Hollywood movies, probably going back to the silent era. You know, think about the cigarettes in something like To Have and Have Not, or the other Bogart and Bacall films, which aren't film noir. But in this film, you've got McMurray lighting the cigar the most repeatedly of Robinson. And that kind of is it's a sly marker of what the real romance is. But it's a competitive romance. It's like anything you can do, I can do better. And so I think one of the reasons that is lurking as a subtext of why after the murders happened, Walter loses interest in Mrs. Dietrich is that what he's really trying to do is beat Keyes by not having the murder be uncovered. And in response to Alan about the Zucchetti plot, and I don't want to steal Hannah's ammo here, but I think the Zucchetti plot is actually a red herring. And, you know, if Walter just takes off for Mexicali and doesn't bleed out while going through several dictaphone discs, Keyes is going to go after Zucchetti as well as the dead woman, but the dead woman doesn't care, which will destroy Lola's romance. So he actually turns into a white knight at the end for Lola. That's the reason to do what he does, you know, and I think that is an injection that's a giant plot modification, I think, on the original material, but Hannah probably knows best.
No, I'm so glad you brought that up, because that is, there's that one moment, and that goes back to Tom's point too about why she can't shoot him. There are like these little glimpses, maybe to get past the censors, that these characters might have some redeeming quality, maybe somewhere, that, you know, Walter Neff, if he disappears, of course, like nobody has any reason to suspect him. So it's gonna, you know, and he has set it up so that he knew he was going there to kill Phyllis. Nino was 15 minutes behind him and the police were behind Nino. And so all that he needed to do was leave the scene and Nino would be implicated in not just the husband's death, but in Phyllis's death too. And he does get him off the scene and he gets him out of the picture so that, you know, he can clear him too. Absolutely. Yeah.
John?
Such a great job introducing and contextualizing this, Hannah. As always, you bring such great clarity to the films and things that we haven't thought about. I really like Keith's point about, and I think Risa also mentioned with the matches and the lighting the cigars. There's so many nice touches, nice small touches in this movie. It's like people's favorite scenes, just little things that make the film just about perfect. The fact that he's flicking out and lighting Keyes's cigar all the time. And then that the relationship is between Neff and Keyes. And then at the end, as he's bleeding, you know, possibly to death, it's reversed and he can't light the match and Keyes lights Neff's. I mean, it's just a beautiful bringing everything full circle and underlining, you know, what's happening emotionally in the film. Yeah, I also agree with someone made the point that the fact that Phyllis, it's just about a perfect film. And when something is so well done, you kind of look for just the little things that aren't quite perfect, is the fact that Phyllis doesn't shoot him a second time, that she has this, you know, second thoughts is to me, the more I see the film, the more that is the only thing that really, you know, stands out to me. And the one thing you mentioned briefly that I wanted to underline was the cinematography by John Seitz, which is so amazing, particularly the way that he lights the scenes, the fact that it's like virtuoso low-key lighting with, you know, no fill light behind it, but all lit with shadows. And it's practically some of the scenes in in the residence are practically in the living room are practically black. It's, you know, it's like Godfather 2 almost in its levels. And it was really, we just accept that type of, and obviously German expressionism had that, but this is the cinematography of noir, just textbook in the way that it's set up, the same way that the Chandler dialogue is textbook script for a noir. It just checks every box possible to make it an essential noir. And I think that's why Eddie Muller, you know, has named it the essential, besides the fact that it set the whole noir movement in motion. And one thing at the end here, you showed The Postman Always Rings Twice, that pulp paperback. I have the pulp paperback here.
Of Double Indemnity,
which was printed in a vintage copy printed in 1950.
Oh, that's so amazing.
It's also a great, they don't make paperbacks like this. They don't make paperbacks at all.
That is so great. What a great collector's item. Yeah, I mean, your point about sites of cinematography bears so much. I mean, we could do a whole talk about that, but so many tropes of film noir were really, in terms of the visual style of it, were virtually invented by this movie. And Seitz wanted to shoot it in what he called newsreel style. And he was going for what he called, you know, a really realistic look. Of course, we would think of it as very stylistic, but he was going for something that was not glossy and sugar-coated kind of Hollywood, you know, look. And he did all these crazy things. I mean, he used like silver dust in the air to light it, to give that effect of the waning sunlight in the room. All that light through the Venetian blinds. I mean, that became so overused in noir, but really this is where it began. And the idea that they are always in shadows and always, even in sunny California. I mean, this is like also James M. Cain's whole thing, is that like in these California, environments, also in Postman Always Rings Twice, in these sunny, you know, baking hot places, there's such a dark, underbelly, so to speak. And so that's where this lighting kind of creates this world. And Barbara Stanwyck said that when she came onto the set, that it was half the work was done for her because it was all the mood that they created. She said it was one big sensational mood on that set, and that it was kind of impossible not to be like sucked into it, because they just created such a style with that, especially in the house. I know we have a couple more minutes and I see some more hands, so yeah.
Back to you, Brian.
I just wanted to comment on why Phyllis doesn't shoot Neff a second time. Phyllis always has somebody else does her dirty work. She does kill the first wife in a very passive way of leaving a window open. She has Neff kill her husband, and she's pretty much setting up Nino to kill Neff. That way she gets to keep the money, and it seems like she would be able to control Nino much more. Because when she does shoot Neff the first time, she seems almost shocked that she did it. She just, you know, she's not used to getting her hands dirty and doing her own crime. I think that's why she didn't shoot first, shoot him dead. Plus, if she shot him a second time, we wouldn't have that great ending.
Right. So.
That's a wonderful, wonderful point. Yes, absolutely. Yes.
And Edward, back to you.
Well, I'm just going to mention one technical side of this that has always intrigued me, and that is that it isn't clear that the way in which the husband was murdered wouldn't have been detected by a competent coroner. And because there is a difference. I made a little study of this. Actually in other films too, there's something called coup and counter coup. So there are ways to analyze how somebody has been killed by blunt force and whether it was the result of falling or whether somebody struck them. And I think for the purpose of the film and for the purpose of the wonderful dialogue, I would not be pedantic and insist on it. And yet it is something, it's something that really kind of haunts me, just as, for example, the idea that diluted penicillin in the third man could have resulted in those terrible condition of those kids. And I actually, when I was in publishing, one of my authors is a historian of medicine, we corresponded about this, and he actually said that diluting penicillin actually could actually be a good idea, especially in circumstances like that. However, in the real case in the third man, the penicillin had been cut with toxic substances, so that was the basis of it. But anyway, if there's any medical person in this audience who can enlighten me on that, I would appreciate it.
I love it. I think it's all a matter of how the director is able to sell it, and we just roll with it in the movie. But yes, absolutely, those are great points. Yeah.
John?
I just have one objection to what you did say, Hannah, in your introduction, and that you said that Barbara Stanwyck may be one of the greatest actresses of all time. She is the greatest actress in Hollywood history. And talking about the death made me think of her, the way they filmed the murder, with just focusing on her facial expression. And that is one of the most, that just shows what an amazing actress she was. It's like a Mona Lisa, just the barest smile and emotion comes across her face as the murder is being committed off camera. It's really just a testament to what a great, a reactive actress she really was.
Absolutely. Her range was incredible and so subtle, and how she could inhabit these different characters, and you almost don't know she's doing it. It's kind of like the Spencer Tracy effect.
I've never seen her in a role in which she wasn't totally believable,
right?
Totally convincing. And she wasn't always in great movies.
Absolutely.
But she was always, in a lot of always, movies. Yeah. Always the best part of any movie she was in.
Yeah. So Polly, yeah.
Yeah, I completely agree. That reaction shot to the murder is, you know, you get this sense that she's getting a bit of a thrill out of it, and it's just really creepy and but so well played at such a fine level. I also wanted to point out, I don't like all of the minor actors in this, but it doesn't matter because the leads to me are so incredible. But I love to see, I think his name is Porter Hall.
Yeah.
From a lot of my favorite sort of screwball comedies. Yeah. And Preston Sturges, the guy from Oregon.
Yeah.
Don't, he won't let you forget it. Right. Yeah. He's great. And if you were with us way back when we talked about the Thin Man, he's the lawyer. I'm sure you've seen the Thin Man by now, but he's a big character in that one. Yeah. I know we're coming up on the hour, and I want to be respectful of everyone's time, but I would love to know, and maybe in the chat, other noirs that you would love to talk more about, since we're in noir territory. We do have the next couple movies picked out, but definitely there are future plans. So and yes, Alan, I do hope everyone will be back for The Shop Around the Corner. Really a wonderful, wonderful, heartwarming movie. The antithesis of Double Indemnity, if you will. A good antidote to this. But yeah, if you have a favorite film noir and you want to put it in the chat or shout it out.
Out of the past.
Or getting some recommendations. Say it again, John.
Out of the past.
Out of the past. Great. I'm watching the chat if you want to put some in here. There are some great ones. Actually, right now on TCM, and I will forgive you if you duck out right now to go watch it. There's one of these great underrated, it's called Where the Sidewalk Ends, starring Dana Andrews. It's a really wonderful film noir. It's Dana Andrews month on Turner Classic Movies every Tuesday. You'll see some of his films. Great. And Noir Alley, of course, is the weekly feature on Turner Classic Movies, Saturdays at midnight, and then it reprises Sunday mornings.
Eddie Muller hosts a different noir film every week. These are excellent, excellent recommendations. As they pour in, I just want to remind you, so next month, August 16th, we'll be talking about Born Yesterday for another masterclass in female acting. I hope you'll join us for that one. Thank you all so much for being here tonight.
Thank you, Hannah, and thank you, everyone. And again, yeah, two classics in August, Shop Around the Corner on the 2nd, Born Yesterday on the 16th. So we'll hope to see you back for both of those.
And they will be in the theaters too. So definitely check to see what times you'll get to see them on the big screen. Great, thank you, everybody.